Welcome everybody. Today we will discuss a new chapter, Cell, the Unit of Life. This is chapter 8 of class 11th biology. Let me tell you what we will discuss in this chapter. We'll discuss, first of all, we'll discuss the introduction to the cell, which will include discovery of cell, then cell theory, prokaryotic cell, then eukaryotic cell, cell membrane, cell wall, then the structure of cytoplasm, then nucleus. And we'll also discuss the function of various parts of a cell. So let us start our first discussion, that is introduction to cell and prokaryotic cell. So what is cell? Just as you know that when we are building any something like any wall or any building, then it is made up of bricks. Similarly, the plant bodies and animal bodies are also made up of the structure, the structural units called cells. That means all living organisms, that is plants and animals, they have cellular organization. The organisms like amoeba, paramecium, bacteria, chlamydomonas, they are unicellular. That means their body is made up of one cell only. But there are number of organisms like plants and animals whose body is made up of many cells, and such type of organisms are called multicellular. So from this it is clear that it may be unicellular, may it be multicellular, but the body of living organism composed of a cell. So, cell is the structural and functional unit of all living beings. So, here in this picture, we can see that the organisms, the living organisms may be unicellular or multicellular. And you can see the unicellular organisms, their body is made up of only one cell. Whereas in multicellular organisms, the plants are there and animals are also there. So, whose body composed of many cells and they are multicellular. Okay. Now, you all know about the discovery of a cell. So, the cell was discovered by Robert Hooke. But that cell which was discovered by Robert Hooke was the dead cell. Remember, children. The dead cell was discovered by Robert Hooke and it was in the year 1665. And how he discovered that also you know, that is he discovered it by taking the help of a primitive type of microscope. I'll show you the picture of primitive microscope which was used by Robert Hooke. And the material he had taken for viewing the cell was the cork. Okay. But later on, Anton von Leeuwenhoek first saw and described a live cell. Okay. Living cell was first described and discovered by Anton von Leeuwenhoek. And then inside the cell, there are several structures, and these structures were discovered by many other scientists, and few of them I am mentioning here. Robert Bowne discovered the nucleus of the cell. J.E. Purkinje used the term protoplasm for the living substance present inside the cell. And as the improvement of a microscope took place, and as the electron microscope was invented, the structure of cell was revealed, and the internal structure and the function of each and every part of the cell was revealed. So here in this picture you can see that he is Robert Hooke. In 1665 he used this type of primitive microscope, and this is the cork, the material that was taken by him to view the cells. And the cells were the he observed this cell as the honeycomb like structures. So he called it as the cellular means chamber. So since they were chamber like structures, so he called it cellular means chamber. Now as I said that after the discovery, after the invention of the electron microscope, the detailed study of the cell was revealed. So let me tell you something about the electron microscope. It was developed by Max Knoll and Ernest Ruska. It's very, very important, children. This is the question that often asked in the NEET. And Knoll and Ruska invented the electron microscope. And it is a large sized microscope. I will show you the picture, which has an internal vacuum, high voltage. And you can see how much voltage is required for the working of this type of microscope. 50,000 to 1 lakh volt. And a cooling system is there. A fast beam of electrons, that is a cathode filament of tungsten and electromagnetic lenses, are the part of this electron microscope. And what is the speciality, and why it can reveal the minute structure, minutely the structure of cell? Because it can magnify the objects up to 2 lakh times. Okay, but nowadays the electron microscope has been developed to such an extent that it can be magnified, any object can be magnified up to 2,50,000 to 4 lakh times. Okay, so it's it has high resolving power, and it is about 100 times more than that of the light microscope. The most important thing, children, you have to remember that the study of living cell cannot be done through this microscope because of the high voltage, very, very important, which is required to operate it. The high voltage is required to operate the electron microscope, but at high voltage, the cell will die. Okay, so it cannot be used for the study of the living cell. So here you can see how huge is this electron microscope, and it requires a complete room, and it's functioning also equally complex. Okay, so I'm not talking much about this electron microscope. Now next portion, let us discuss, that is cell theory. And all of you know that the cell theory was proposed by the German botanist M. J. Schiedén in 1838 and a British zoologist T. Schwann in 1839. And they gave the concept, what is cell theory, or what is their postulations? They gave the concept that all living organisms are composed of cell and products of cells. Schiedén and Schwann together formulated this cell theory, but this theory did not explain how new cells were formed. They failed to explain. So the cell theory was not complete. But the first concept was given by Theodor Schwann and M.J. Schiedén. Okay. Then one of the most important thing, children, you have to remember, viruses, viroids and prions that we have discussed in our first chapter are exception to the cell theory because they are obligate parasite. That means they don't have their lively existence outside the host cell. Outside the host cell, they are non-living. So we cannot say that are inclusive of cell theory. They are exception to the cell theory. Now, what is the final shape of the cell theory and how it got the final shape? Rudolf Virchow gave final shape to the cell theory, and Rudolf Virchow in 1855 first explained that cells divide and new cells are formed from the pre-existing cell. In his language, omnis cellulae cellula. He modified the hypothesis of Seiden and Schwann to give the cell theory a final shape. So what was the final concept of cell theory? He added a new point to the cell theory that was given by M.J. Seiden and Schwann, and following are the points after the concept given by Rudolf Virchow. So what are these? All living organisms are composed of cells and products of cell. This was given by Schwann and Seiden. But all cells arising from pre-existing cell, that was given by Virchow. Then membrane-bound cell organelles of the protoplasm do not survive along or outside the protoplasm. That means whatever organelles, as the discoveries were there after the invention of the advanced microscope, the cell organelles were discovered and that they were also included in the cell theory. So the cell organelles cannot survive along, that means cannot survive outside the protoplasm, because protoplasm is the living mass, and all cells have similar fundamental structure and metabolic reactions. But they can also perform specific function that we'll discuss later on. That is not a part of cell theory. Then genetic information is stored as DNA in the chromosome present in the nucleus. That you all know. So regarding the shape of the cell, the shape of the cell is basically related to their function. So here you can see some types of cells with a different shape. As you can see that the RBC, they are round and biconcave, so that easily they can be carried through the fluid. Then white blood cells are amoeboid, so that they can be moved easily from one part of the body to the other part through the bloodstream. Then columnar epithelial cells are elongated, long, narrow. They generally help in absorption. Then you can see the nerve cells, which are branched, elongated. They help in conduction of impulses. So in this way, similarly, you can see the plant cells also. So there, the shape of the cell is on the basis of the function they perform. Then size of the cell, it is also greatly varies. The cell differs greatly size, shape and activities, as I said. For example, mycoplasma is the smallest cell and they are only 0.3 micrometer in length, while bacteria could be 3 to 5 micrometer. And among multicellular organism, RBC are about 7.0 micrometer in diameter. And the nerve cells are some of the longest cells. So here you can see the shape and size of the cells. So if you look into the structure of any matter, that the smallest structure that is having free existence is the atom. Then atom is the smallest one. Then you can compare how the size of the cell. So then lipid is bigger than the atom, then protein is bigger than the lipid, then you can see the viruses are bigger than the protein, and then you can see that mitochondria is the largest cell organelle, and you can see the bacterial cell whose size is almost equal to the structure of a mitochondria. Then You can see the animal cell and the plant cell, which are composed of many organelles like mitochondria. So they are bigger than the bacteria. Then you can see that some more bigger cells are the frog egg, then chicken egg, and eggs of other animals. And the largest cell is the ostrich egg. Okay. So this is just a comparative account of the size of the cell. So here I have shown you only few types of cells. And now we'll discuss the types of cells. Depending upon the nature of the nucleus, the cells are of two types. That is prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell that you have studied in class 9. But here we'll discuss each type of cell in details. So, before discussing the each type of cell, we should know what are the structures common to all cells, that is both to prokaryote and eukaryote. The common structures are the nuclear membrane. From inside to outside, I'm telling nuclear membrane, which is the membrane of the nucleus. Then coming to the cytoplasm. Cytoplasm is present in all type of cell, that is prokaryote and eukaryote. Okay. And then the cell organelle. Among cell organelle, the ribosomes are present in all type of cell. And then cell membrane is the outermost membrane. I am repeating, the common structures are from outer to inner, I am telling now. Cell membrane, then cytoplasm. The cytoplasm contains the cell organelle, that is ribosome, which is common to all cell. Then the nucleus. But here I would like to tell you, the nucleus is absent in prokaryotic cell, but a nuclear region is there. That means the nuclear material is there. Okay. So the common structures are cell membrane, cytoplasm, and a nuclear region. Okay. Then here you can see some the examples of prokaryotic cells. And what are prokaryotes? The prokaryotic cells are unicellular organisms. And they are mainly bacteria, blue-green algae, mycoplasma. In first chapter, I have told you that is PPLO, pleuropneumonia-like organism. So here is the bacteria. Then this is the structure of mycoplasma. And this is Nostoc and Anabina. That is blue-green algae, which forms a filamentous structure. Now, we have already discussed our previous chapter, the classification of or grouping of the prokaryotic cells basing on their shape. So this is the classification of the bacteria on the basis of their shape. So here you can see Cauchy are the dot shaped or spherical shaped bacteria, then rod shaped bacilli, then Spirilla, spiral shaped, which are usually having flagellum, and Vibrio. Vibrio are the coma shaped. Okay. Then now let us discuss the basic structure of prokaryotic cells. All prokaryotes have a cell wall, very, very important, which is present around the cell membrane, and the cell membrane encloses the cytoplasm. Okay. The most important thing is that they don't have a definite nucleus, but they have a nuclear region that is called nucleoid. And in the nuclear region, the DNA is a naked circular one. And it is the genetic material. Okay. Besides this DNA, which is present in the nuclear region. In some bacteria, another DNA is present, which is small circular, that is called plasmid. Very, very important. What is the plasmid? Plasmid is the extra chromosomal circular DNA present in some of the bacteria. They are not present in all bacteria. Okay. And what is the importance of this plasmid? The plasmids or this specific type of DNA are having some unique sites like resistance to antibiotics, or they may be regulating synthesis of certain proteins or enzymes. They can also monitor bacterial transformation with the foreign DNA. Bacterial transformation means transfer of the DNA from one bacteria to another bacteria through a culture media. Okay, so that we will discuss in class 12th. I am not telling much about the transformation. Now, in the plasma, on the plasma membrane, there are some circular coiled bodies called mesosome, which is found only in case of bacteria, children. You have to remember this. These are simply foldings of the plasma membrane, nothing else. And what is the speciality of this mesosome? The mesosome contain respiratory enzymes like oxidase and dehydrogenase, and they help in cellular respiration. That means they function like the mitochondria. The bacteria do not have, bacterias do not have the mitochondria. So, but the cellular respiration is required for the survival of the cell. So, who performs that? The mesosome performs the cellular respiration. And besides that, mesosome also helps in cell wall formation, DNA replication, and distribution of the DNA to the daughter cells. Okay? And besides that, let me tell you, in case of, in the cytoplasm of the prokaryotic cell, the membrane-bound cell organelles are absent. Only ribosome is present, okay, which is not membrane-bound. So, here we can see the structure of a bacterial cell, okay. So, here this is the cell wall. As I said, they, all the bacteria have cell wall. Then below the cell wall, you can see that is a plasma membrane. Okay, so here three distinct colors are there. The brown color is the plasma membrane. Above that, there is a light pink color layer, that is plasma, that is the cell wall. And above the cell wall, there is another capsular covering. Okay, that is called slimy capsule, which is not present in all bacteria. That may be present in some bacteria. Okay. So now you can see in the membrane, some foldings are there, coiled foldings are there. They are called mesosome, and the mesosome performs the function of mitochondria. Okay. Then I have told you that they have ribosomes, but no other cell organelles are present. Then you can see this is the nuclear region where actually a single chromosome, which is looped, you can say it is single DNA which is looped, is present. But besides that, another DNA is also present in its cytoplasm in some of the bacteria, not in all bacteria, that is called plasmid DNA. Okay. Then in some bacteria, the flagellum is present. The bacteria which are motile, they have flagellum. And the bacteria have other structures like pili and fimbriae are also there. And I'll discuss their structure and function as I move ahead. Okay. Now, let us first discuss the cell envelope and its modifications in details. The cell envelope of bacteria consists of a three-layered structure. The outermost layer is made up of glycocalyx, then which is the capsule, as I have shown you. Okay, so this is the glycocalyx. The blue color layer was is the glycocalyx. The below that the cell wall is there, and then below the cell wall or inner to the cell wall the plasma membrane is there. Okay, so that slimy capsule which I have shown you, that is made up of polysaccharide and nitrogenous substance, and its main function is to provide protection against the phagocytosis and antibiotics. Okay, now here you can see the cell envelope structure very clearly. It is shown here. You can see this is plasma membrane, then outer to plasma membrane the cell wall is present. The cell wall composed of two layer, that is one layer that is made up of peptidoglycan, and outermost layer of the cell wall is here, and the next in some bacteria, as I said, there is a slimy capsule which is made up of polysaccharide and nitrogenous compound is there. So this is the capsule which is resistant to the antibiotics. Now the most important thing I want to tell you about the bacteria is that the bacteria are grouped into two categories depending upon their staining property, that is gram positive and gram negative bacteria. So in this picture I'll be showing you the structure of gram positive and gram negative bacteria, then I'll tell you what is gram positive and what is gram negative. So here in the on the left side here you can see that in this type of bacteria, this is the cell envelope of the bacteria. So here you can see this is cell membrane, then the peptidoglycan cell wall is present in gram positive bacteria. The peptidoglycan cell wall is very thick. Okay, but in case of gram negative bacteria, you can see that the peptidoglycan layer is thin and the outer membrane is thick. Okay, so this is the basic difference between gram positive and gram negative bacteria, and because of which the staining property of the two types of bacteria differ. And depending upon the staining property by Gram's stain. What is Gram's stain? I'll tell you. Stain, they are gram positive and gram negative. That means the gram positive bacteria can hold the stain, gram stain, whereas the gram negative bacteria cannot hold the Gram's stain. Now let us see what is gram positive and gram negative actually, and how this staining property is determined. So here this is, these are the bacteria. Okay, the group of bacteria. So the Gram's stain composed of the crystal violet and iodine. Okay, so when it is the gram the bacterias are treated with crystal violet and iodine, then they get stained with purple color. Okay, so here you can see both the group of bacteria get the purple color. Okay, but when it is treated with the acid alcohol or acetone, it was observed that there is one group of bacteria which could hold the purple color, or purple, that is crystal violet, the violet color of the stain, but the other bacteria could not hold the color, that is the violet color of the stain, and it becomes colorless. And in order to identify these colorless bacteria, they are stained with counter stain, that is safranin, and they become pink. Okay, But here in this case, you can see that the violet color persists in their membrane, so they're purple or the violet color, but here they're pink color due to the safranin stain. Okay, then why it occurs? Because in gram-positive bacteria, the peptidoglycan layer is very thick and it can hold the stain. But in case of gram-negative bacteria, it cannot hold the stain because it is very thin. So, when it is treated with acetone or acid alcohol, it is decolorized or destained. Okay, so this is the reason why they are called gram positive and gram negative, and on what basis they are grouped as gram positive and gram negative? Basing on the staining property with the grams stain, that is crystal violet and iodine treatment. And why such difference is there? This difference is due to the composition of their cell membrane. Okay. And here are the some of the examples of gram positive and gram negative bacteria. So here you can see that is the acetic acid bacteria, which is usually used to prepare the vinegar, Xanthomonas, then Gymomonas, Pantuae, E. coli, Vibrio cholera, Salmonella, Pseudomonas, periodontal disease bacteria. So these are all gram negative bacteria. And here are the gram positive bacteria where peptidoglycan is thick. They are lactic acid bacteria, Bifidobacterium, Staphylococcus, then Mycobacterium, Anthrax, Enterococci, Streptococcus pneumonia, Hemolytic bacteria, Clostridium botulicum. Here are only few examples I have given. So these are the gram positive and gram negative bacteria. Let us see what are the difference. Now, if we look into the number of layers, the gram positive has only one layer, whereas in gram negative they have two layers, that is the cell wall and peptidoglycan. If you look into the thickness of the gram positive and gram negative bacteria, the thickness of peptidoglycan is in case of gram positive it is thick, but in gram negative it is thin. The outer membrane is absent in case of gram positive, whereas in gram negative the outer membrane is present. Then chemical composition of the gram positive membrane is peptidoglycan, teichoic acid and lipoteichoic acid. This is very important, children. This composition you have to remember. But in case of gram negative bacteria, the membrane composition is lipopolysaccharide and lipoproteins and peptidoglycans. Okay. And in case of gram positive bacteria, the purine proteins or the protein channels are very less. That's why it can hold the stain. But in case of gram negative bacteria, purine proteins or the channel proteins are more. That's why it cannot hold the stain. Okay. Then the gram positive bacteria are more penetratable, whereas the gram negative bacteria are less penetratable. That means permeability. I'm talking about the permeability. Okay. Now on the cell envelope, I have shown you the structure, the flagella. If the bacteria is motile, then they have a filamentous structure, that is called flagella. But the flagellar structure of bacteria is totally different from that of the eukaryotic cell. And this is very important, children. The bacterial flagellum is composed of three parts: filament, hook and basal body. The filament is the longest portion, and besides flagella, I have shown you that they have also pili and fimbriae. Okay, so let us first see the flagella. So here in this picture you can see the bacteria is having many flagella. So they may have one flagella or many flagella. So that depends upon the type of bacteria. And this is the structure of the flagella. This is the electron microscopic structure, and this is the detailed structure of a flagella. So here you can see it has, as I said, it has basal body, hook and filament. Okay, so this basal body is embedded in the membrane and the filament is projected out of the membrane. Okay, the next I have told you about the pili and fimbriae are the other outgrowths from the membrane. Then what are these pili and fimbriae? So here you can see these are the structures that is like spike-like structures called fimbriae. They are bristle-like and present in large number. So these, you can see in this picture, there are a number of fimbriae. Okay, and what is their function? They help the bacteria to adhere to the host tissue. Okay, so the this is see the difference between pili and the fimbriae. The fimbriae are bristle like and they are present in large number, and they help the bacteria to attach to the host tissue. Whereas the pili, you can see the long bristle like structure, and they are limited in number. Okay, they are much longer than the fimbriae. Okay, they may be present in pair or singly. Okay, and what is their function? They help in adhering of two bacterial cell for the transfer of DNA. So this is the main difference, functional difference between fimbriae and pili. Okay, so I hope it is clear to you. Then as I said you that the cytoplasm composed of only one type of cell organelle, that is ribosomes, but other inclusion bodies are also there in the cytoplasm. Besides ribosome, no other cell organelle is present in the cytoplasm. The cytoplasm is granular. You can see many granules are there there in the cytoplasm. And these granular structures are nothing but the ribosomes. And the ribosomes are often attached to a single mRNA, and that structure is called polyribosome. So what is polyribosome? When a number of ribosomes are held together with the help of a single mRNA, then that structure is called polysome or polyribosome. Okay, and what is the significance of formation of polyribosome? Because in case of bacteria, there is no endoplasmic reticulum. So, the ribosomes do not get surface to attach and to perform the protein synthesis. That's why they attach themselves to the mRNA to perform protein synthesis. Okay, and I was talking to you about the inclusion bodies. The inclusion bodies are nothing but the reserve materials stored in the cytoplasm, that includes the phosphate granule, cyanohysine granules and glycogen granules. And besides that, the gas vacuoles are found in blue-green and purple and green photosynthetic bacteria, okay, for storage of these inclusions. So here in this picture, you can see the polyribosomes, okay. So this is a mRNA, single mRNA, the blue color thread-like structure to which a number of ribosomes are attached. This is to facilitate the process of protein synthesis. Okay, so here you can see this is the detailed structure of a bacterial cell, and here I'll just show you the ribosomes. These are the ribosomes, okay, which forms the polyribosome or polygerms, and these are the inclusion bodies which may be enclosed in the vacuoles. Now, the most important difference in the ribosome of prokaryotic cell and eukaryotic cell is that in prokaryotes, the ribosomes are 70S type, whereas in eukaryote, it is 80S type. That means, what is 70S? What for S stands? S is the sedimentation coefficient or Sydberg unit. Okay, so let me tell you in details, what is this 70S or 80S, 50S, 30S, what is this? Actually, when the scientists wanted to reveal the structure of cytoplasm, what are there actually inside the cytoplasm, they homogenized the cell, then they centrifuged the cell. So when they centrifuged, you know, centrifuge is a machine which consists of a rotor, and to that rotor, in the rotor, the test tube holders are there, and in the test tube we have to take the homogenizer. Okay, the homogenized cell. Homogenized cell means the fragmented cell. So now when it is centrifuged, it was observed that in the test tube, the position where 70 was there, the ribosomes were found when the bacterial cell was studied. But when the eukaryotic cell was studied, the ribosomes were observed in the position, or the sedimented in the 80 position. That's why they are called as 80S, but in bacteria, since it was sedimented at 70 position, so it is called 70S. Okay. Now, this 70S ribosome of the bacteria composed of two subunits. One is larger subunit, which is 50S, and the smaller subunit, which is 30S. Okay. And they together constitute the 70S. So, don't get confused that 50 plus 30 is 80. It is not 70. So, it is not the sum of the two figures. It is the position where they sediment. Position of the test tube where they sediment. Okay. So, that's why it is 50 and 30. Okay. So, I think it is clear to you. So, this is the small unit. Again, this small unit composed of many smallest unit, and again this larger subunit consists of many small subunits that we'll discuss in higher classes. That is, okay. Then next, in this session we discussed about the prokaryotic cell and very specific structure. I discussed that is, the flagella is different, the ribosome is different, the specific structures are pili and fimbriae, then the difference between gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. So, these things are, children, very important from examination point of view. Okay. And I hope this topic of this particular chapter is very much clear to you, because this portion is new to you. Because in class 9th, you have studied only the difference between prokaryotic and eukaryotic cell, but not the detailed structure of the prokaryotic cell. So, in our next session, we'll discuss the eukaryotic cell. And because eukaryotic cell is more complex than the prokaryotic cell, that we'll discuss in many sessions. But in our next session, we'll discuss the cell membrane and cell wall of the eukaryotic cell. So, thank you, children, for watching my video. Thank you once again.